Over the last 10 years of me releasing music, I've gained over 300 million streams in total, and there's always been one technique that has been constant throughout my music, and that is sidechain. And in this video, we're going to talk about what exactly sidechaining is, when it should be used, and how to do it. So sidechaining is the technique of making one sound duck in volume while another sound plays. Now, there's two reasons to sidechain. One is for mix and master purposes, and the other is for creative. Now, we use sidechaining for mix and mastering purposes to make sure that the kick and bass work well together. This is especially important in EDM productions because the kick and bass are so loud that they both need their own space. When the kick hits, the bass ducks just like this. Now, if you don't do this, you get a huge spike in the low end. And this is very bad news for your mastering limiter because it is very responsive to low end. So take a look at this. So in short, you get a much louder and more glued together mix when the bass and kick are sidechained. Now the creative use is that we get this nice pumping effect, which you're going to be very familiar with when I show you the example now. Just listen to this bass loop. What I'm going to do is I'm going to start bringing in the threshold here, which will start bringing in more sidechain as this goes on. Everyone's very familiar with that. It's used in all types of like dance music as like this really pumping. It just creates a vibe. Just jumping in here to say that I'll be dropping my debut course very soon, building the track from scratch all the way to releasing and marketing the track. Join the waitlist now by clicking the link in the description. Let's get back in. Okay, so that's the why of sidechain. Now here's the how. Now there's a few ways that you can sidechain. The easiest and most accessible is through a compressor in your DAW. For instance, here we can use the Ableton compressor. But what you need to do first of all is set up a trigger. So the easiest way you can do this is by just grabbing an empty audio track and searching for a really short sample. I'm going to use a room shot. This is the one I usually use. Very short, and we don't really care about the sound per se, because we're just going to use it as a trigger. We're actually going to turn this track off. So the drums in this really simple, just straight on the 1 and 3. So I'm just going to copy this over all the way. All right, we have our trigger now. You'll hear it's on the kick and snare. Cool. We can turn that off now, and we can just call this SC trigger. Boom. Okay, next, grab a compressor and throw it straight on the group. You can do it individually, but for this purpose, I'm just gonna do it on the whole group so that I could just get to the meat. Okay, so in Ableton, what you do is you press this triangle here. It opens up this sidechain section. Press sidechain, and then audio from, you wanna choose your sidechain trigger. So go up to the top, SC trigger, and you'll see now, I'll put this on there. We've got a trigger. I'm going to set the release to about 40. Attack to 0. I want the sidechain to start straight away. The attack, if I have it all the way up, it's going to take a second before the sidechain actually kicks in. I don't want that. Ratio, I'm going to keep around there. That's fine. So the next thing to really do is start pulling this threshold down. So let me show you this track without sidechain and then show you what it will become with sidechain. Bearing in mind, this is the actual drop stack from after all, and this sounds like shit. So sidechaining adds a huge amount here. Here's the problem that I see on a lot of lessons. Sidechaining tends to be around there. Like it's sidechaining and the setup is correct, but it's not as intense as it's needed. So what I usually do is I'll have 3 sidechains set up. So I'll show you how I do this real quick. So I group the sidechain. I open this guy here. No, I don't. I open the macros and I'll start mapping stuff. So press a map. Threshold, then I'll go ratio, then I'll go attack and release. So undo that. Now I've got all these 4 mapped, and what I can do then is I can copy this over. Two more times, and now I've got 3 compressors going, which obviously looks a bit overkill, but trust me, it's absolutely fine. I prefer doing it this method because if you just crank one compressor, it sounds really overdone, but when you do it like 3 times, not as much, it sounds a lot smoother. And the beauty is I've only got to use this one threshold knob and it's gonna attack all 3 of them. Okay, so here's where I would have this set. Now just compare the difference to, or you know, it's just got that like intensity to it, that push and pull, you know? Yeah, it's just way stronger like that. It's got way more of a vibe to it. Now there is another way to sidechain. This is my preferred method now. It's with a third party plugin called Shaperbox 3. Now, the way you set this up, it's pretty similar actually, except you use MIDI triggers instead. So you set up an empty audio track. So you set up an empty MIDI track and then you just put MIDI notes in. So we'll just do that. Boom. So I've got one there. Again, on every kick and snare. So you can just do that. I can just consolidate, boom, 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 boom. And then drop a shaper box onto the track like so. I press this sidechain button. For some reason, for me, I haven't figured out a way to get it to work without doing this, because something goes wrong when you don't have like these points set like that. I don't know the ins and outs of it. I just press that and it works. Right, so first thing you want to do is press MIDI. The reason being is that I've noticed that when you are on the normal sync one or audio, it will do it fine for now, but the more tracks that you add into your project, it'll start shifting out of sync and your sidechain will start feeling a little bit off, like a little bit slow or a little bit too fast. And then you have to do a lot of like this kind of stuff to get it on back to where it's supposed to be. But if you do it with MIDI, it stays locked into the grid. Of course, then you have to do the MIDI method, but that's fine because it's a really simple setup. So now that we've done that and we've chose MIDI, all we do is send our MIDI track here. We press no output and we send that to the group that, well, wherever your shaper box is. So free group. Make sure that this underneath is set to shaper box. Because if you've got loads of other tracks on there, like you've got ProQ Freeze and I don't know, some other stuff, it'll choose whatever's first in your signal chain. So just make sure that that is on shaper box. Okay, so now that that's set up, let's go back to shaper box. This should be working now. Yep. Now what you can do from here is you can really dive in deep on the actual curve, which I really am a fan of. You can also set like note length, the grid length. I don't know. This, you know what I'm trying to say. I usually go to a half a bar and you'll hear that this is a bit more of a longer sidechain now. This is cool for some uses. Personally, that's too fast of a sidechain for me. So we can go half a bar. Honestly, that doesn't feel far off where I'd have it, but let me just walk you through the points that I use here. So I clicked on this one to begin with because it's a curve at the moment, but if you click it, it becomes a straight line. And I keep this line at the bottom. I use this section here for like the length of my kick. Now you can actually, the cool thing about this is we could send the drums to this. I could go down here and choose kick. Now I can see my kick. So I can sort of determine how long I want this by that. So it looks like my kick starts rolling off at about here-ish. So I want this somewhere between there and there. The next one is how fast it's going to come back up. So if it's super like that, not really the vibe I'm going for. If I bring it back this way, it's a lot faster. That's a little too fast for me. I'm going to find like a middle ground. This is like the same thing, but on the opposite end, like how quick you want it to reach the top. And this is the point where I want it to return back to normal. So I do want to bring it back a little bit, maybe there. Now, the really cool thing about Shaperbox as well is that you can separate the bands, the frequency bands. So So for instance, there might be occasions where you don't want the higher end stuff like your leads and simps to be as intensely sidechained as the low end. So what you can do is you can drag either side here. It doesn't really matter. But for this, I'm just going to drag this way. And now I've created two bands almost equal. You hear how this high end isn't getting sidechained anymore. You can actually just click on them and... But this is. It's really cool. So now what I can do is I can right click in here, press copy wave, go into this guy, press paste wave. And if I wanted to, I could make this a little bit faster. I could also turn the mix down on just this one. So now that I've got my sub sidechaining a lot harder than the other stuff, which is something you might want to do in some cases. For this track, I was happy for it all just to feel like one big thing. This is why I love Shaperbox. There's so much more control. You don't have to have it. It's just I'm a nerd. I'm a nerd. I love playing with all the different dials and stuff. There's nothing wrong with doing the compressor method. It does the exact same trick. And in fact, on this song, I use the compressor method. But since then, I've switched to Shaperbox and I'm just a fan. Now, if you found some value in this video, please drop me a like and subscribe. It would mean the world to me to help this channel grow. And if you want to take your learning a step further, join me at the Sound Horizon Academy or jump on a one-on-one session where I can help you with your music. Peace.